Hello viewer, welcome to Science Hub. This is Moi Forces Academy, Form 3 Physics. My name is Trevor Kanog.
And I'm John Kamako.
And my name is Severin Okoth.
So today, the topic of the day is the first topic in Form 3, linear motion. And there are other forms of motions, there's circular motion and oscillatory motion. But what is this linear motion?
So Trevor, linear motion is something very easy. It comes from two simple English words, a line and motion. So from that, we can deduce that linear motion is movement along a specified line.
Oh, that's true, don't you think, Severin?
Yeah, I think it's true, and I think I can also describe what circular motion is. Circular motion, this is movement in a rotational manner, as in moving along a circle but in a path. I think Trevor can elaborate in such a manner. And Kamau, do you know what oscillatory motion is?
Yeah, oscillatory motion, this is fast movement due to vibrations. Like, for example, a wave. Can see this? See this? So that's the main position. So when a body comes out of here, it comes out of here and goes down, comes back up, goes down. See, it's moving in a wave like man. So that's oscillatory type of movement.
Yes. Now, in this topic, linear motion, there are some terms we need to discuss. One term is displacement. Trevor, what is displacement?
Displacement is the distance moved by a body in a specified direction.
Like, I can illustrate it. I know I'm standing here. Isn't it, Trevor?
Yes.
Just give me some space. So this is the north. So I'm moving two steps due north. Then I'll turn, move two steps due south. So as you see there, I moved two steps. That's the distance. But the direction was due north and due south. So that means that displacement is
distance in a specified direction.
Yes, and I think I need to elaborate to the viewer the difference between displacement and a path.
Okay.
I think I should. Now, take for example, this is you over here, and you're supposed to get to another point, say here. You can decide to take two ways to reach to that point. You can either move in such a manner to get to your point, or you can move and find the shortest distance towards the point you're going. As you can see, this distance from here to here is shorter than the distance covered as you go in a wave-like manner. So this is what we call displacement, the distance, the shortest distance between two points, or also the distance moved in a specified direction. And this one here, which is not in a specified direction, we call it a path.
And just to emphasize, here you just put that mark to show that that's displacement. There's direction defining that.
So to make it simple, displacement, direction. Distance, no direction, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, there are also other terms. The one that every driver, matatu driver loves, speed.
Yeah. So every matatu rider might love it or hate it, but speed is constant. Speed is the distance covered per unit time. Like I can say, I moved from Nairobi to Nakuru, which is a distance of 150 kilometers in 2 hours. So the average speed was 75 kilometers per hour. That's the speed. Distance moved per unit time.
Yeah, this.
So that's speed, distance per unit time.
Yes, and we know that distance is measured in meters and time is measured in seconds. So from this equation here, we can derive that the units for measuring speed is in meters per second, or as other people know it, it might be kilometers per hour or centimeters per second, depending on how short the distance is.
Yeah, that is true. And just like distance has displacement, speed also has velocity.
Yeah.
What is velocity?
Velocity is defined as the change in displacement of a body per unit time. Trevor, can you elaborate on this?
So we had said that distance, speed, is equal to distance per unit time. So now we have velocity. Velocity, we told you it was displacement, and I'll put that just to show you the direction, essence of displacement per unit time. That's the only difference.
Yeah.
So now, Let us go to another word, acceleration. When a body is moving, is at rest, and then the car begins, gains speed, now that is acceleration. It is defined as the change of velocity per unit time.
Yes.
Can you elaborate on that?
So, for example, we can check this. I'll tell you an example. For example, the body was at rest. Its speed was that? 0 kilometers per hour. Then, after a while, it will move and get to 50 kilometers per hour. Then yet, it will still accelerate and move to 80 kilometers per hour. As you can see, the velocity is actually changing. It's changing as the car gains momentum. So this upward trend in the velocity of the car per unit time is what we call acceleration.
Yeah, I also like to add on to that, we should also take into consideration that acceleration takes time for it to happen. So for a body to accelerate from 0 kilometers per hour to 50 kilometers per hour, then to 80 kilometers per hour, it means that it has taken some time. So to calculate the acceleration of this body from 0 to 50 kilometers per hour, we take the final velocity, which is 50 kilometers per hour. You subtract 0, which was the initial velocity, over the time taken. Let's say it took 3 seconds, or let's say 5 seconds. If it has changed from 0 to 50 kilometers per hour in 5 seconds, the acceleration will be 50 divided by 5, which will be 10 meters, which will be 10 meters per second squared. Yeah.
Emphasis in the square. So that's what distinguishes speed, velocity, and acceleration, the square. Okay. So from there, we can go onto the motion graphs.
Yeah, the motion graphs.
I was telling you, Trevor, there is something called motion graphs in linear motion. Could you elaborate further?
Yeah, motion graphs. Every time you take that graph book, just know that you can draw a graph of speed against distance, of time against distance. And just for an example, we can also draw a graph of a stationary body.
Let's take this as our graph board.
For a stationary body, it does not cover any distance, but remember, time keeps flying. So, you'll find that if it was at this position, the graph moves parallel to the x-axis, because the distance does not move, but the time keeps moving. Any other graphs, John?
Yeah, I would like Severin to emphasize on the type of graph.
There's another type of graph whereby a body is moving with a uniform speed. I'd like you to elaborate on that. If a body is moving with uniform speed, it means that it is gaining distance at equal distances at equal time intervals. To elaborate on that, let's say it was at 0 meters when the time was 0, and when the time was 1 second, it had gained 1 meter. So if this point here is 1 meter and here is 1 second, the point will be plotted. Let's say after 10 seconds. After 10 seconds, the body will have gained 10 meters. So from 10 seconds, let's say 10 seconds is here, and 10 meters is here, the point is plotted here. Then, from that, we can draw a graph which will pass through these points like this. As you realize, this graph shows that the body is accelerating with uniform speed, because it is covering equal distances in equal time intervals. Yeah. Kamau, can you elaborate on the graph of a body moving with a variable speed?
Yeah, I will. So, let's take this instant. As I was telling you earlier on, bodies move and some usually accelerate. So, for example, the body started at 0 meters at 0 seconds, isn't it? So this is the origin, we plot it here. Then after a while, it's actually moving more distance in less time. It's covering more distance in less time. So like, for example, we say this is 5 meters, and 5 meters, it's taken 2 seconds, isn't it?
Yeah.
We can see an irregular pattern here. So we'll plot our point here, and the original point was here. Then at 10 meters, it's still at 4 seconds. So we plot it here. So when we come back and finalize, we'll just join them together. And you'll find out that you find a graph of this nature, where there is, a graph of this nature. This shows that that body was covering more time, more distance in less time, or it was covering less distance in more time. So this is a graph of variable speed.
Yeah, so now let's go to the next thing. How?
He has done a mistake. He has not done it correctly. Can we repeat?
No. Not correctly. Oh yeah.
Okay. Let's repeat. There's also another graph which is known as a graph of a body moving with a variable speed. I'd like my friend Kamau to elaborate more on that.
Okay. So sometimes you see that as the body moves, it actually covers more distance in less time. For example, a matter will start moving at 1 meter in 1 second.
Mm-hmm.
Then after a while, you see that it's at 10 seconds, but it's covered 50 meters.
Mm-hmm.
So that matter is actually moving very fast. So for example, you can see this is the origin. At this point, this distance, this is time. In seconds, and this is in meters. So, as we can see, this is our point of origin. At this point, the matatu has covered zero distance, zero seconds, isn't it?
Yeah.
But after a while, we can see that it's covered 5 meters in 5 seconds. But due to acceleration, we can see that at 10 meters, we expect it to have covered 10 seconds, isn't it? But because it's accelerating, it's at, let's say, 7 seconds. So you find something like this. Now that way and that way. So when you join this graph, it will come out. Then you do it back. So you can see the depression. So you can see that there is a depression in here.
Yeah.
Meaning the car was covering more distance in less time. This is a graph of variable speed.
Yeah. This graph, it simply shows that this body was moving with an increasing speed. The speed is undefinable. It is increasing with a uniform speed. There's also a speed time graph. This speed time graph, there are graphs of different kinds. The first speed time graph elaborates a body with no speed, but the time is moving. Let me elaborate on this. Now, the first one, as I said, the body is with no speed. If the body has no speed, it is not moving. On this y-axis, we plot the speed. And on this x-axis, we plot the time. As we know, this body is not increasing in speed or in any other way. So it means that this body, as the speed is zero, the time is moving. So it means that that graph will be along the x-axis, whereby the time is moving, but the speed is at zero. Yeah. Yeah, let's get on to area under a velocity time graph.
So let me help you, Trevor. So sometimes when you want to find the distance, you don't necessarily need to calculate the time and the distance. You can just plot a graph of the distance and the time and use the area to work out the distance covered.
Yeah.
Isn't it?
Yes.
Like, for example, I can use this example here. Okay. So we have this velocity, and this is time. So normally, to find distance, you use speed over time. So this can be corrected for this, isn't it? But here, you actually don't need that. You can plot the graph of distance against time, and that's the graph of velocity against time. Then, use the area under the graph. So you just come and plot it. This area down here. This area that is shaded represents the distance covered by velocity. Like for example, here it was 8, and here is 10. So normally how we do calculate the area of our triangle, it's a half, yes, height. So yes.
The base is 8.
Exactly. And the height is
10.
8 and 10. So the distance covered will be 50 meters.
Yeah, that is true. And now away from graphs and everything. So let's go to something else. How do we measure this speed, velocity, and acceleration? I don't know if speed governors, John.
Oh, Trevor, that's I'm sorry for you, but here in the lab, we measure the speed, the acceleration, and velocity using a ticker timer. Several, will you explain to the viewer what a ticker timer is?
Yeah, a ticker timer is a simple device used to measure short distances. It is found in the laboratory and it uses electricity from the main power source, the mains. This device, it is used to make constant dots on a tape, which is attached to a moving trolley. As this trolley moves, it pulls the tape along the ticker timer as it makes dots on it. I like to elaborate using a chart. Yes.
Okay, so as Severin was explaining earlier on, this refers to the ribbon that we get when a ticker timer moves. So for example, we have this, the first one. As you can see, when the ticker timer moves, it makes some dots. You can see the first dot, second dot, third dot, fourth dot, you can see. So if that ticker timer is moving at a uniform speed, it will make dots at regular intervals. So as you represented here, this x represents the distance in between the two dots. Okay, and because the ticker timer is moving at uniform speed, it will make dots at regular intervals, meaning the distance in between each dot will be equal. So here we represented it as x. For example, x could be 1 centimeter. So if it's moving at uniform speed, it will cover 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay, Trevor, explain this.
So a ticker timer usually moves, the trolley moves in a specific direction. If it is increasing in speed, and let's say the direction moved is given with the arrow, you'll find that the length between the dots, it keeps on increasing and increasing. This shows that after the ticker timer has put a dot on the ribbon, it will move a lengthier distance, then another dot, another lengthier distance than the prior one, and another dot. So the distance keeps increasing. The space keeps increasing, showing that the speed is increasing. So
yeah, on to the decreasing speed. As Kamo told you, this is called a tick, and between this one here, it's a time interval. Let's say take it as 1 second. But as you notice, as when the ticker timer is moving in a decreasing speed, the distance covered tends to be shorter as the distance is covered. But one point for you that you have to notice is that even though this distance is not equal to this distance covered here, the time interval is the same. Yeah. So if you see a graph of a ticker timer tape moving in such a direction, it shows that it is decreasing in speed.
Yeah. So a point of emphasis, as you will stated down here, when the dots are close together, the motion is slow. For example, here. So this means the ticker timer was moving sluggishly at the beginning, like some people. Then after a while, it started moving, the Julius Yego style, very fast. Again, when the dots are very far apart, the motion is very slow. Then, when the dots are very far apart, the motion is very fast. This is a point of correction. The motion is very fast, like here. From here to here to here. You can see this distance is great, and it keeps on diminishing. meaning that it takes the same time to make these big distances, these big dots, to make these big dots. So my point of emphasis is that when the dots are far apart, the ticker timer is moving very fast. When they are close together, it's moving sluggishly.
Yeah, so let us now go to the science in this. We find that it uses a DC motor, isn't it?
Yes.
And it uses its frequency, which is 50 hertz, isn't it? So yeah. What does this 50 hertz mean?
You can remove that.
Yes.
Yeah, I hope that you have understood how the ticker timer works, and I'd like to elaborate more on how it works. I'd like to tell you that a ticker timer uses a DC motor, and this motor has a frequency of, it is usually of 50 hertz. This 50 hertz means that it makes 50 dots in 1 second. So if it makes 50 dots in 1 second, if in one second it makes 50 seconds, what about one dot? How long will one dot take? So if 50 dots is 1 second, what about one dot? So you cross multiply, then you divide 1 by 50. If you have your calculators, you'll find that the answer here is 0.027. So it means the time interval between one dot to another is 0.02 seconds. Trevor, can you help me here?
I have a question.
Yes.
So, and then if I just draw the ribbon, this distance and this distance, this is all 0.02 seconds.
Yeah, the distance from this dot to this one and this dot to this one, even though the distance might look long, the time taken to do this is the same because the frequency is 50 hertz.
Yeah.
From here to here it's 0.02 seconds, and from here to here is also 0.02 seconds. Yeah.
So. Yeah. So to emphasize on that, I hope you have your pens and books and calculators ready. I'm going to give you an example. So I'll read it twice for you to get it down. So here you go. A tape is pulled through a ticker timer, which makes one dot every second. A tape is pulled through a ticker timer, which makes one dot every second. If it makes 3 dots and the distance between the first and the third is 16 centimeters, find the velocity of the tape. So the question goes, a tape is pulled through a ticker timer and which makes one dot every second. If it makes 3 dots and the distance between the first and the third dot is 16 centimeters, find the velocity of the tape. So let me give you the solution. So, let me just give you an example of the ribbon. You've been told it's pulled through the ticker timer, and which makes one dot every second. So we have the first ribbon, the first dot, the second, and the third. Here. So, this is the first, the second, and the third dot. Between these 2 dots, the ticker timer has covered 16 centimeters. So let me see. So I hope the viewer has gotten the question. So Severin, do that question for us.
Yeah. I'd like to tell you, the viewer, this question is very easy if you follow the steps that I'm going to show you. Okay, so we have been told that this ticker timer has a frequency of 1 hertz. A point to note, in a question such as this, it is very important for you to take note of the frequency of the ticker timer. This is because this frequency here, it is going to tell us how long it takes to make a dot, which means the time interval between here, how much time was taken from this dot to this one, and this one to this one. So if it is 1 hertz, it means that it makes one dot in 1 second. So it means that this space here is 1 second. And this other here is another second, isn't it? So if it took 2 seconds to cover a distance of 16 centimeters, what is its speed? From the previous lesson,
As I defined earlier, speed equals to distance over time. So the distance is 16 centimeters.
And the distance is 16 centimeters, and you have found that the time is 2 seconds. So you divide 16 centimeters by 2 seconds, which is 8 meters.
Centimeters
per second. Yeah. Let's proceed.
We shall proceed to another example. Trevor, please read to them.
I'll read to you another example, and this is how to calculate acceleration using a ticker timer. And I will read the question. A tape in the figure below was produced by a ticker timer with a frequency of 100 Hz, and here's the figure. And so the question is, find the acceleration of the object which was being pulled by the tape. So this question is very simple. One, we have been told that the hertz of this ticker timer is 100 hertz.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that the time taken between two dots is 0.01 seconds, which is gotten by taking 1 second over 100 hertz. So now, the initial velocity will be calculated using the speed, distance, over time. And the time we have is 0, and the distance is 0.5 centimeters. And we know that for one take, we have 0.01 seconds. Or 0.01 seconds. After you calculate it, you'll find that we'll get 50 centimeters per second. The final velocity, which is at the end of the tape, will be calculated using the same formula, 2.5 centimeters over 0.01 seconds. And after calculating it, you'll find that it's 250 centimeters per second. So now the time that is taken between this dot and this dot, we will calculate the number of spaces between both times, both distances, which is 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we'll take 4 spaces times the number of seconds, which is 0.04 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And if we know the formula of getting acceleration, we know that acceleration is equals to v minus u over t. V is the final velocity, the initial velocity, and the time taken. So we have found the time taken at 0.04 seconds. And the initial velocity, we found
250.
Oh, the final velocity, we found it was 250 centimeters per second, which is minus the initial velocity, 50 meters per second. And after long calculation, what you will find is 5,000 centimeters per second squared.
Okay, so I hope you all recorded that. So we are going, next we are going on to a very interesting part of linear motion, actually the basis of linear motion, and these are the linear motion formulas.
Yeah, they're basically known as the equations of linear motion. They're pretty exciting. Please concentrate.
Yeah, most students usually cram them to what? V, U, A, T, a half, G, T. But we are going to teach you how to derive them. Severin?
Yeah, I'll start with the first formula. As you have known, Trevor told us that acceleration, which is denoted as A, is equal to the final velocity subtract the initial velocity over the time taken. So from this, we can play around with this initials here in order to get a new formula, can't we?
Yes.
Okay, so let's make V, which is the final velocity, the subject of the formula. You can do that by multiplying this side by T and this other side by T. If you multiply both sides by T and this T will cancel out. So it will be left with A T is equals to V minus U. But this equation is still incomplete, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So we can take this U to the other side, which will be equal to U plus A T is equals to V. But to make this equation look more pleasing to the eye, we take this V the other side and this U A T here. So it is, this is also the same as V equals to U plus A T. As you can see, these two are the same, but this one looks better. So this one here, it is the first equation of linear motion, which is V is equals to U plus A T.
So you might want to ask yourself, then how comes, what if we are asked to calculate distance? What formula do we use? We use the same formula, isn't it?
Yes. So, Trevor, when you are asked to calculate distance or displacement, you pretty much use the same formula. And that gives rise to the second equation of linear motion. So, let me teach you how to derive it. At the beginning of the program, we learned that displacement, velocity, equals to displacement over time taken. So, to make d, which is displacement, the subject of the formula, d will be equal to vt, isn't it? So, this is displacement. And this is average velocity, and this is the time taken, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, the average velocity.
Wait, please cut. Najua, in this equation, there will be a point where you write in S.
Yes.
So you could have started in S.
Okay, let me start in S. That's all. So, Trevor, getting the second formula of linear motion, as I told you at the beginning of the program, V equals to S over T. Isn't it? Making S the subject of the formula, S will be Vt, where S is the displacement, V is
the time taken.
V is the velocity and T is the time taken. So S is the displacement, V is the average velocity and T is the time taken. So, but remember that this V, as we learned earlier, the average velocity equals to the initial velocity U plus the final velocity V over 2. And also, so substituting this into our formula, S equals to U plus V over 2 multiplied by T. But remember that from our first formula, which Severin showed us, V equals to U plus A T. So we can substitute this into this formula. So S will be equal to U plus U plus AT, which can be simplified to be 2U plus AT over 2 multiplied by the time taken. So, multiplying everything in the brackets by T, we find S equals to 2UT plus AT squared over 2, which can also be, simplifying this equation, we can find that it will be equal to ut plus a half a t squared. So this is our second equation of linear motion. Just to summarize, we started by saying that the velocity equals to the displacement or the time taken. But making S the subject of the formula, S will be equal to vt. But remember that v is the average velocity, meaning we take the initial velocity u plus the final velocity v divided by 2. So we substituted this into our formula, where f will be equal to u plus v over 2 times the time taken. But remember from our first equation that v equals to u plus h. So we substitute this also into our formula. So we get u plus at. This one unit. We'll find 2u plus at over 2 multiplied by t. So everything in the bracket is multiplied by t, the numerator that is. We find giving us 2ut plus at squared divided by 2. When simplified, we find ut plus a half at squared. And that's the second formula of linear motion.
So let me explain the third equation of linear motion. Over here, you are told that average velocity is equal to initial velocity plus final velocity over 2. And I want us to get time. So let me play around with these letters. If I want time to be the subject of the formula, what will I begin by doing? I'll have to take maybe u to the other side. So v minus u is equal to at. Then I divide both sides by a. And what will we have? T is equal to v minus u over acceleration. So we know that speed is equal to this speed is equal to no, displacement is equal to time times velocity, isn't it? So I'll just replace it with this. Time, we know it's v minus u over a, and we know that average velocity is equal to v plus u over 2. So I'll multiply these figures. If you multiply them, you'll find that v squared minus u squared over 2a is equal to the speed. I'll multiply both sides by 2a. 2as is equal to v squared minus u squared. And I want v squared to be the subject of the formula. So it will just exchange places with 2as. So we'll find that v squared is equal to u squared plus 2as. And that's the third equation of linear motion.
So, as you sum up, I want to tell you some key factors that are usually examinable in linear motion. The first one is free fall. We actually base everything on these three formulas. So, free fall, Trevor, what's free fall?
Free fall. I think everyone knows free fall. If I stand on top of this thing, then I fall down.
That's free fall.
That's free fall. And how do you calculate it? You just exchange acceleration with gravity and use the same formulas.
Yeah. On to the next one, vertical projection. Severin, vertical projection.
Did you see what I just did?
I
threw the chalk up and it came down. That was vertical projection. When you throw something up, it goes against gravity. If it goes against gravity, it means that gravity, which is a form of acceleration, is a negative value. So if you throw something up to calculate, to apply these formulas to calculate things on this one, as it goes up, you just change this positive to be a negative because you're going against gravity. So it will be a negative here, and a negative here.
So from there, we move next to the maximum height reached. So when I throw this, you can see, it reached up there and came back. That's the maximum height reached. And this can be calculated using this formula. Using our first formula. So, Severin will elaborate further.
To calculate the maximum height, as Kamau was saying, there's maximum height. To calculate maximum height, when you throw something up, it reaches a point, it stops and comes down. At the point where it stops, it means the final velocity is zero. From the first equation, which was v is equal to u plus minus at, because u is zero, to calculate the
So, as I was saying earlier, the maximum height reached. The maximum height reached there. So, from our equation, we found that V equals to U minus GT. But when I throw this chalk, piece of chalk up, when it reaches its maximum height, the velocity is Z. So, this final velocity becomes Z. U minus GT. So, U, U will be equal to. But we want to find the t. So t is equal to u over t.
Yes.
So the time taken to reach the maximum height will be given by the initial velocity u over the gravity g, which is there.
So when you're asked different questions in linear motion, whatever you have been asked, use our equations and make it the subject of the formula, and you'll get your answer. Your correct answer, I bet, isn't it?
You get your correct answer.
So, workered in physics, this was Linear Motion with Moi Forces Academy.
On Elimu TV, where you watch.
So, I'll join Kanao.
Trevor Kanao Gung.
And I am Severino Koth.
See you later.